Grace and peace to the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship at San Francisco Theological Seminary on this day of the James A. Symposium. And what a morning it has been. We are honored today to have the chaplain in the pulpit, the Reverend Dante Quick. Reverend Quick is the pastor at Friendship Missionary Baptist Church in Vallejo, a friend of San Francisco Theological Seminary and of many people in this room. Also been pastor of New Liberation Presbyterian Church. And and has served so many church and government organizations, working for justice at the intersection of faith and public life. Reverend Quick, thank you for being here. We are looking forward to the work that you will bring. Reverend Quick was also a student of Dr. James Noel, and Dr. Noel was his PhD advisor, so I thought it would be appropriate just to have anyone who was a student of Dr. Noel stand. There are many of us in this room. Let us stand. Yeah. Friends, a couple weeks ago, I heard an interview with Ruby Sales, and she said this about theology. Theology should have hindsight and insight and foresight. Today, that is embodied in the Noel Symposium Lecture Hall and in this room. This is the day that God has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
This is the house of God, where all are welcome and all are loved.
This is the place where the apostles cry out for peace and justice and righteousness.
We are summoned here by our God.
Thank you.
join me in our prayer of confession. God forgives and heals us.
We need your healing, merciful God. Give us true repentance. Some sins are plain to us. Some escape us. Some we cannot fix. Forgive us. Set us free to hear your word to us. Set us free to serve you.
Amen. Hear this word of grace. To all who turn from sin and sorrow, to all who turn to God in hope, this is God's word of grace. We are accepted. We are forgiven. We are loved. This gift we have from God.
Thanks be to God.
Blessed are those who make peace. They shall be called daughters and sons of God. We meet in the name of Christ and share Christ's peace. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Done to his oxen. Then the dread of the Lord fell upon the people, and they came out as one. When he mustered them at Bezek, those from Israel were 300,000, and those from Judah, 70,000. They said to the messengers who had come, "Thus shall you say to the inhabitants of Jabesh, Gilead, tomorrow by the time the sun is hot, you shall have deliverance." And the messengers came and told the inhabitants of Jabesh. They rejoiced. So the inhabitants of Jabesh said, "Tomorrow we will give ourselves up to you, and you may do to us whatever seems good to you." The next day, Saul put the people in three companies. At the morning watch, they came into the camp and cut down the Ammonites until the heat of the day. And those who survived were scattered, so that no two of them were left together. These are the words of Scripture.
Let us pray. God of our weary ears, God of our silent tears, we praise you this morning, this afternoon. We thank you for this opportunity to lift up the name and the memory of James Noel. We honor this moment of Scripture, the talent of the people who sit before us, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
For just a few moments, query with me on the thought, going to meet the man.
Yeah.
To my womanist sisters, please excuse me for this temporary lapse. But this does not come from me. I am echoing the thoughts of James Baldwin, his classic essay, Going to Meet the Man. And even today, as I stand here, I stand and must first honor Roland Gordon. The robe I wear was worn by three men, the followers of Dr. Farley. Three men who became the second generation pioneers of African American Presbyterianism in the Bay Area. Frank Jackson.
Yes.
Roland Gordon.
Yes.
James Noel.
Yes.
All three donned this robe. All three became fathers to me. The robe I wear today was bequeathed to me by Frank Jackson's widow. For me, it is a conjuring. The way African Americans have conjured for centuries. Noel might make me say it signifies the strength of a faith in men and women who will stand in front of injustice and say, God is not pleased. And going to see the man, Baldwin describes an inept sheriff. A sheriff who is surrounded by noise and stuck in the iron. Text today. of different tribes stuck in the belly of a shade shifter, unable to speak a common language, it's through the moan that they develop into a people. Who sits high and looks on. There is a God with us in the belly of this ship, and that God will see us through our existential crisis.
Yes.
Just as Saul finds himself in the midst of a people stuck in a preoccupation about ontology, this people, chosen by God and yet surrounded by judgment, surrounded by occupation, surrounded by the cruelty of occupiers, this people, chosen by God, forced constantly into existential crisis. How can you explain to be God's people and yet find yourself under oppression? Your very being challenged day after day. I reflect on what I call moanful memory. Yeah. Because when we pull back on where we've been, we must remember what God has already done.
Yes.
That the existential crisis is just for a moment, because weeping will endure for a night, but joy always comes in the morning.
Yes.
God visits this man. He hears the cry of his people, and as he hears the cry of his people, we are told that the Spirit enters him, and his anger is kindled.
Yeah.
I talked to Jake Noel twice a day for 5 years.
Yes, sir.
He was a man who was incessantly angry.
Yes. Yes.
But there's a difference between being angry just to be mad.
Right.
But we've got to go to a book called Black Preaching to get into something.
Oh,
we need to turn to Henry Mitchell and his Tell It Like It Is hermeneutic. Also, a nitty gritty hermeneutic. I go to Mitchell rather than Anthony Penn because Penn loses the emotional and religious attachment involved in the hermeneutic. See, you can't just read the Bible as a piece of literature. Only when the Spirit enters you.
Life got difficult.
He remembered the silence of the night when he could not perform properly with his wife. He was so preoccupied, Baldwin says, he began to think about the black women that he would sneak over to the other part of town and get with. Yeah. He began to try to imagine his wife as one of those black women. Yeah. But it didn't just quite work. And I wonder what did the silence puzzle him about? Why did he need the Negro singing to stop? And why did the silence of his bedroom could he not perform like a man? What was it about the silence that bothered him? Did he peek through the silence to what long called opaque vision and see kingdoms of kings and queens robed in kente, raising their children, brutalized across the modern Atlantic Ocean? Did he see the past sins that he was not ready to repent for? Or did he see an eschatological vision? Did he see God opening up the heavens, riding through on a white horse, saying, I will set my people free? Did he see what Herod saw? And did he see what Sojourner saw? Did he see that God will one day come back to this place and revenge all the blood that runs to the breach to heal all the crying of black mamas and black wives? Don't you shoot him! Don't you shoot him! Yes.
Preach, Dr.
Don't you shoot him! Church needs to go see the man.
Yes.
And once again,
yes.
Be inhabited by the Ruach,
yes.
The Word of God.
For the
people.
Thank you.
God of Deborah.
Yeah.
Esther.
Yeah.
Rachel.
Yeah.
God that has flowed from generation to generation.
Yes.
Rest, rule, and abide upon each and every one.
Yeah.
And yes,
yeah.
Make you angry.
Yeah.
Now and forever. Ashe.